Okay, we go back to yesterday what I said. The Indian housewife decorates a doorway with rangoli or alpana or kolam. This is an all India phenomenon made of rice flour to feed her ants and insects. She waters the tulsi plant which is in the courtyard of her house, and the tulsi prevents coughs, colds, fevers. She prays that her bath water may be as sacred as the Ganga, which has proven antimicrobial properties. She circumambulates the peepal tree. It's a ritual which binds the Indus Valley, the Vedic, Hindu, Buddhist, Jain traditions. More importantly, the peepal tree releases oxygen day and night, unlike other trees which release it only for 12 hours. She feeds the crows. She says she's feeding her ancestors. But the real purpose of this is that the crows keep the outer environment clean. She sweeps the house only in the daylight. I mean, if you talk to your grandmothers, they will tell you all this. The main thing is that small insects which are lodged in nooks will be dislodged if you sweep at night. So that is how careful the housewife is of her environment. Every aspect of her life is intimately connected to nature and scientific environmental management. Unfortunately, all that was good and which was preserved in the name of culture and tradition has been discarded in the name of modernization and development. How many of us over here water the tulsi every day, do a rangoli outside the house? You do very good. Very good, young man. I'm very happy to hear that. I do, but I don't think too many people do that. Sorry? Yeah, if they do it good, but if you go to the city, I mean, if you go to Ahmedabad city or Chennai city or Mumbai city or Delhi, you will not see it at all. But many of our ancient environmental traditions are still preserved in rural India. And what is amazing is the commonality of these traditions from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, and I said yesterday, Dwarka to Dibrugarh, which begs the question, I mean, who said the British invented the idea of India? This happened long ago, long before the British even knew that there was a place like India, or the Indians knew that there were people like the British. This has been going on for millennia. The British came here 200 years ago, or 250, whatever. So all nature has been sacred. The sacred forests of ancient India are today the sacred groves. The sacred gardens of ancient India are today the Nandavanam of temples. The sacred trees continue as the Sthalavriksha of temples. Sacred rivers, water bodies, tanks, sacred animals, sacred mountains. So all these traditions continue. We just don't realize that the sacred ecology has continued in our lives. Now let's start with forests. I want to tell you a little bit about how forests were managed in ancient India. There was a very close symbiotic relationship between people and nature. And we know that the country was thickly forested because Indus Saraswati seals show wild animals such as the elephant, water buffalo, tiger, rhinoceros, deer, gazelle, antelope, and so on. Where in the Punjab? Can you imagine tigers in the Punjab? I don't know if anyone here is from the Punjab. Have you ever seen a tiger there? I can't even imagine such a thing. I don't think anyone can. But it was there. And in fact, that's not the subject. Babbitt tells us that he says he killed 20,000 rhinoceros in that Punjab region. So that is the kind of wildlife there has been in India. Those were the forests of India, which were first destroyed by the sultans, then the Mughals, and then finally by the British as they cut down the trees to expand the railways, to build the railways. And what were the railways built for? Not to take me on a sightseeing tour to Kashmir, but for the British to load the timber and the carpets from Kashmir and take it to Bombay port and push it off to England. The Vedas, as I told you yesterday, have a clear appreciation of the natural world and its ecology and the importance of the environment and the management of natural resources. Now, forests were places of retreat. All through our literature, Sanskrit literature, we know of rishis living in forests. So these were places of retreat, a source of inspiration. And all Vedic literature was revealed to the sages in the forests. We don't find any literature being revealed in the king's palace. It was all in the forest. And I've just brought a few quotes. So may the mountains, the waters, plants, heaven, earth, etc. preserve for us those riches. Aranya means forest. And early Vedic religion has the Aranyakas, which represents an earlier sections of the Vedas, which were the speculations on the philosophy behind the rituals. And one of the most beautiful hymns of the Rig Veda is dedicated to Aranyani, who never returns in Indian literature, but she lives on as all the Devis, the Ammans, and so on, and all the goddesses, Bhudevi, Annapurna, Amman, and so on, in all the goddesses, Bon Devi, Bon Bibi in Bengal. Just to go back to Aranya, just in case you think the Aranyas are gone, they are not. They're still there. Is anyone here from Rajasthan? You are from Rajasthan? Have you heard of Orans? No? Yes, around Alwar, that region, there are Orans. They are also there in Jodhpur. I went all around Rajasthan. And Oran comes from the word Aranya. And these were the Aranyas of the Aranyaka. And I went to one Oran, I forget the name of that Oran, and it was amazing. I felt I had been transported in time because the same identical pits which they would have had for havans long ago are there. And there was a Baba sitting. He was also growing cannabis beside him. That's by the way. And I thought this must be the Somarasa which takes him to heaven or whatever. But apart from the cannabis, everybody gives their first bag of their produce, the grain, to him. He had it in a big room, and every morning and evening he would just throw it out, and the peacocks and the birds and the deer, all the animals came. It was just the most beautiful sight. I thought I was living in Shakuntala, Abhijnana Shakuntala of Kalidasa. It was such a romantic sight. I've never seen such a sight in my life. So these Aranyas, the Orans, because don't forget, they were situated along the Saraswati, which is beneath, today it is beneath the Thar Desert. Now, there were three categories of forests in the Vedas, Tapovana, Mahavana, and Shrivana. Tapovan was the refuge for meditation. It was an Abhayaranya or a sanctuary where the rishis, the sages lived, and the kings came there. The kings went to the rishis for advice. Rishis did not go to the king. The Mahavana was the great forest where all the wildlife lived. And the Shrivana was the area which was used for exploitation, which provided prosperity. That's why they say Shri. It was maintained by temples and set aside exclusively for religious use. Now, Rama's entire journey from Ayodhya to Lanka was through forests. And Ramayana is a botanist's delight. A few years ago, when I had read the Ramayana long ago, and when I read it, I remember as they entered Dandakaranya, Bharadwaja tells Rama, be careful. There are lions and tigers in Dandakaranya. And I said, come on, what does Bharadwaja know or Valmiki know? You can't have lions and tigers in the same forest. Till I went to Bhimbetka, and I was shocked to see a painting of a tiger and a lion together. Then I said, oh my God, this is Dandakaranya. And you do have lions and tigers together. So I sent off two of my scientists, a botanist and a zoologist, made them travel from Chitrakoot all the way down to Lanka and document all the plants that they saw. And there is absolutely no change from what Valmiki wrote. It is amazing. So there was no exotic plant over there, no... what is that famous one in Kashmir? Michelle, what is that famous Kashmiri tree? Chinar or something? Chinar. None of those trees. It was just the trees which you find today in these places, including a place like Kishkinda, which is very rocky, quite dry, and yet you have the Tungabhadra over there. You have the Godavari, you have the Panchavati, the five banyan trees, and so on. So it's absolutely amazing that it was so correct. And I have mentioned, please read what I've said. I don't want to read out everything. In Kishkinda, it's exactly as per Valmiki's description. Obviously, Valmiki went to all these places. Most important in forest management was what the Arthashastra wrote, Chanakya. He describes different forest types. The Mrigavana for deer, Dravyavana, which were the economic forests which could be exploited, Pakshivana for birds, Pashuvana, Vyalavana for wildlife, and this was reserved for tigers, wild animals, and then Hastivana, that was very important because the king needed elephants, which he used in war. And Dravyavana was the source of the forest produce. In the Arthashastra, deforestation and illicit tree felling was punishable with a fine and a levy. And ecological balance was maintained by appointed forest managers. So long before the British thought of forest management, Chanakya was doing it in ancient Magadha. And the protection of different species of animals was an important duty of the state. So much so that many towns and villages in India were and still are named after plants and animals. Just to give you an example, Vrindavan is named after the Vrinda or Tulsi plant. And Mylapore in Chennai is the city of peacocks. Mail means peacock. I can go on giving you such examples, but if you just sit down and... Yes? Sorry? No difference. They're both forests. They're the same. I think one is a more modern word, you know. Usage of language changes, especially in Sanskrit. The most famous forest, of course, was the Naimisharanya. And a lot of things happened in that forest. Because the Mahabharata was narrated to Shaunaka over there. Vishnu killed the demon Durjaya. Lava Kusha chanted the epic Ramayana to their father in this forest. The Bhagavata Mahapurana was recited here. The Satyanarayana Vrata Katha originated here. Balarama visited it during his pilgrimage. Tulsidas, most recently, composed his Ramcharitmanas over here. So obviously there's something very magical. And believe me, there's something very magical about sacred groves. I have been to so many, and I have taken foreigners also who are alien, and they say there's something very magical. Unless you go into a grove, the sound changes from outside the forest, and the birds and the insects, they are practically responding to your voice. I mean, over here, the birds will be chirping and we'll be talking. But over there, they're responding. Please go to a grove and see it. So what are these sacred groves? I think you discussed it earlier. The home of local flora and fauna. So I would call it a mini biosphere reserve. We have the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, the Gulf of Manarsu, and all over the country. This is a mini biosphere reserve, and that is why even the very small groves are important, because these were the plants imported in that area. The rich plant life retains subsoil water. There are unique forms. It's a unique form of biodiversity conservation, whereby religion and tradition are used to conserve ecology and heritage, natural heritage. It's an area of conservation as well as a spiritual retreat. As I said, in the Oran that we saw in Rajasthan, this Baba was sitting and he was praying twice a day, and he insisted I had tea. I was very nervous that it may have been laced with some bug. Fortunately, it was not. But he was also praying over there. And I've gone to so many groves. Every grove belongs to some deity. Maybe a mother goddess. It may be whatever, depending on the local tradition. But generally, they are mother goddesses. The tradition goes back to food-gathering societies who venerated nature and natural resources. They were the tapovana, where the ashrams of rishis were located. And these were very significant reservoirs of biodiversity. You know, in some districts, because having worked in Tamil Nadu a great deal, I found village to village, the local sacred grove has totally different plant species. And I don't even understand why, because they're just a few kilometers apart, maybe 50 kilometers apart, which is nothing. But the tree species are different, and even when we restore them, we ask the old people, the senior citizens of the village, what was there when you were children? And then they tell us, and those are the only plants that we plant over there. So what is the ecological significance of these groves? Firstly, most important, conservation of biodiversity, because they're the last refuge of endemic species in a geographic region. They recharge the aquifers and they conserve the soil. The vegetation cover improves the soil stability of the area and prevents soil erosion. The degree of sanctity accorded to the sacred groves varies. In some forests, even dry foliage and fallen fruits are not touched. People believe that any kind of disturbance will offend the local deity and cause diseases, natural calamities or failure of crops. So they will not touch anything. In northeastern India, Garos and Khasis prevent any human interference. They do not even permit non-Garos or non-Khasis to enter their grove. Then in some places, dead wood or dried leaves, generally this is permitted, may be picked up to cook prasad during the festival. But a live tree and its branches can never be cut. Goans of central India prohibit the cutting of a tree but allow the fallen parts to be used. It's amazing that even children are not permitted to urinate, and they do not, you know. We Indians are dirty people. We throw everything everywhere and use every place as a public urinal, whatever, defecation and so on. But out of respect for the deities within, nobody does anything. I was amazed that Indians could have so much discipline, naturally. I mean, of course, here in cities, it's forced on people, but there it's different. And medicinal plants are preserved in the groves, and they are accessed generally by the women during an illness, disease, etc. Michelle asked, Professor Danino mentioned that he wasn't sure where such things continued, such groves. I was invited to the rededication of a sacred grove in Japan. And this belonged to the royal family. It's a Shinto grove. And they had 3,000 acres. And the rules were exactly like the groves in India. Nothing. They had a, only thing is we don't build a toilet outside. They had very modern toilets outside. If you wanted, you use it. Then you go to the grove. We walked through 3,000 acres, mind you. Nobody does anything. It's a beautiful place and it's maintained, but it's the people use it to walk and so on. Other places where you find it are in Africa, in parts of Africa, where such groves continue to be found. Now, the sacred groves belong to the local deity, generally the mother goddess. And another very interesting All India phenomenon is the gift of terracotta animals, generally the horse. It is believed that either she or one of her assistants will get onto the terracotta horses at night and roam around the border of the village, prevent evil spirits and disease and all from entering. This is again an All India phenomenon. I have the famous Bankura horse of Bengal. Are the terracotta horses gifted in sacred groves? The Ayyanar horses of Tamil Nadu. I've seen horses gifted in Gujarat, in Goa, or every. Do you know there are even sacred groves in Kashmir? The gods of the groves can be grouped under gods of rain and fertility. This is most important. Boundary gods, protectors who prevent disease. Sitala Devi, she is generally found inside groves. Kali is generally at the edge of forests. Hero stones are also found inside groves, because generally somebody would have gone there, come across a tiger or a leopard and fought it and died. And snake stones, especially in Kerala, the groves are called Sarpakavu, and they're all dedicated to the snake god. See, they can be, you're seeing the pictures. Now, nobody has any idea how old they are, because they are gifted every time. Somebody, his son may be ill, he'll take a vow. If my son gets well and comes home okay, I will gift a terracotta horse. So some may be old, and because it's terracotta, it doesn't stand the test of time. They break down, but some do last. But we don't know how old, but the tradition is very, very old. It is mentioned in Sanskrit literature. It is mentioned in Tamil literature of at least 2,000 years. So we know that these horses have been given. How do you find out the time? You really don't. I've put up pictures. Sometimes they're painted again and again, like at Puthupet in Tamil Nadu, I think this one, the first one, they paint the horses. In Asanur in Virupuram, they paint only the main deities. They don't paint the others. In Goa, you can see the Paikapan of Saturli village. These horses are all kept in a big bundle over here. They're all just grouped together. And here, this is another grove in Arunachal Pradesh, where they don't have this horse tradition, but they build these beautiful monasteries over there. So this gives you some idea of the groves we have documented. There are many, many more. And I'm going to read out the local names for sacred groves. And this is the reason I'm reading this, is to show you that this is not something that belongs to any one part of India. Andhra Pradesh, it's called Pavitravana. Arunachalam Pradesh, Gompa Forest. Assam, it's called sacred grove. I'm sure there's an Assamese word. I haven't been able to get it. Bihar, it's called Sarhuli. Chhattisgarh, it's Mataguri. Goa, Deorai, Pan. Gujarat, you have Sabarkantha, Dahod, Banaskantha. These are all the sacred groves. Haryana, it's called a Gurdwara grove. Himachal Pradesh, Kul Devta. Himachal Pradesh has lots of groves for a very small state. Jammu and Kashmir has these burns, bani. And you'll be surprised that many of them are looked after by the local Muslims. They probably don't know it's supposed to be a sacred grove, but they look after them. Jharkhand, Sarna, Karnataka has many names. Devravana, Devrakadu, Huli Devrakadu, Nagvan, Bhattapavana, Jatakapanbana, Gaudibana, Kan. Now, Huli Devrakadu, I must tell you, Huli means tiger. In Maharashtra and Karnataka, the gods of the sacred groves are the tiger. And when I went to Karnataka and I saw this image of the tiger, I said, why are you worshipping the tiger? I mean, it'll kill all of us, you and me. So they said, no, the tiger, if the tiger is protected, then we know that the forest will be protected, the rain will come, everything. So we today, our biologists tell us that the tigers at the top of the biodiversity pyramid. Now, they knew this long, long ago. So this is native knowledge. In Kerala, of course, you have the Sarpakavu. Madhya Pradesh, you have the Sarana, Devkot, Matikot, Devasthali, Buddha Dev. Maharashtra, you have Van, Devvan, Deorai, Devgudi, Pengada, Manipur. I won't read out all the names. Just to tell you this, it goes right down to West Bengal. Every state has this tradition. So, was India an idea of the British? So, what are the threats? Firstly, the disappearing of traditional beliefs to systems. Many people feel, local people, that this is some kind of primitive religion. They don't. Urbanization, development activities. This beautiful sacred grove, the earlier one which I showed you, that picture, the first one, at Puthupet, was one of the most beautiful groves I'd ever seen. And it's the only grove which had tropical evergreen plants. The local people asked the HR, Hindu Religious and Charitable Endowment Board, to build them a Pakka temple with a Gopuram and a Vimanam and everything. And they have a road going through it. And they've changed. I've mentioned changing forms of worship. They have a very formal Vedic worship. And people come with, somebody asked me yesterday about flowers and fruits in a plastic bag. They give over there, throw the bag outside. It has become a horrible place. Very sad. Religious conversions. Northeast India, that's a big problem. The groves are disappearing because of religious conversions to Christianity. There is no more sanctity attached to the groves. Then invasion of exotic species. Species like Prosopis, Lantana, these are entering the groves and they just take over the whole place and destroy many of the native endemic species. And then, of course, increasing livestock and fuel wood collection. Although you are not supposed to allow your cattle into the grove, many people, the rich landowners, say, I will let my cattle go. What can you do? What can anyone do? They're too scared to fight it. You'll be a politician. You'll have the backing of a politician. So, this is one more reason. So with that, I've come to the end of the sacred groves, yes? Buddhist, Jain. But in all the regional literature, it is mentioned. And especially when you go to each state, the worship in the grove is not necessarily in Sanskrit. It will be in the local language. And in the local dialect, you know, in Madhya Pradesh, I saw the worship at a grove. I couldn't understand it. It was not Sanskrit. It was not Hindi. They said some language. It was a local dialect. So it is very localized. It's my village, my grove. Yes. Yes. Can you use the mic, please? I can't hear you too well. Okay. You can speak loud. I think if you speak into the mic, everyone can hear your question.
Okay, thank you. So, I come from Andhra Pradesh and I have noticed many Grama Devatas and like forest deities. I have seen temples where there are no people living. They are actually deserted places. So I was wondering how they are related to the Vedic deities and like how do the people interact, these people, like?
See, Hinduism is a religion which absorbs everything. You must remember that. So these Grama Devatas are considered to be a part of Hinduism. So the villager will go to the Grama Devata. Now in my village, Draupadi is the Grama Devata. We have another my village has Punni, next village has Draupadi. And next to it is a village of, is the temple of Shiva. A little further away is a big temple of Vishnu. So that has never bothered the people. They'll go. The problem is with other religions. You know, when they convert to, say, Christianity, the pastor will tell them, do not enter. That is the heart of the devil. So that is where the problem comes in. Whereas the others, I mean, Jains go to, there are a lot of Jains in my region. I come from near Kanchipuram, from Kanchipuram itself. There are a lot of Jains then. In fact, my curator of our museum is a Jain. She comes with me to the Grama Devata. She comes with me to the Shiva temple, the Vishnu temple. There is no this thing, separation. So, yeah, nobody will live inside a grove. They will live in the village, visit the grove, come back. They go there only to pray. And once a year in every grove, they have a festival where the whole village gets together. But otherwise, it'll be one family. The child may have chicken pox or something. So the mother and the father will go and pray. So each family has personal concerns. So at that time, they will only go as individuals and pray. Then we come to the Nandavanam, the gardens. These are maintained to provide flowers for the temples. Now, these are actually cultivated horticultural gardens. They are places for meditation and healing. And they generally have fruit trees and flowering trees which are planted near the tanks and settlements. Now, there are three types. Nandavanam, where many of the leelas are supposed to have taken place, especially the whole Krishna Leela took place in various gardens. And every temple generally has a Nandavanam. Nobody sees it. But they'll have a little compound at the back where the flowers are grown for the daily puja, if the temple has enough space. The Buddhist gardens are also important because they were a place for meditation and healing. As you know, the Buddha was born in a garden in Lumbini, and his first sight of the first first sermon was given in the deer park at Sarnath. So these are both gardens. And these are now World Heritage Sites. That's why monasteries in India still have gardens. The Bagh Bagicha are ethno-Silvi horticultural gardens, traditionally planted near tanks, settlements, and these are generally found in North India with utility trees. And generally, in all these different gardens, green felling is totally banned. There is a temple or a separate space for the gods. One thing I would like to just mention here is that Muslims also have sacred gardens like the Taj. The garden in the Taj is supposed to be a replication of paradise as per the Quran. So many mosques have this kind of very beautiful temples which are supposed to replicate paradise. Then we come to the next sanctity accorded to plants and trees. So we find tree worship on Indus Valley seals, and trees were recognized as animate and having life, and the value of the plants were known. Now, these trees, long before temples were built, you had a deity under a tree. The trees were the first temples. Let us not forget that. But in time, when the temple culture took over, people would build a tree, build a temple, put the deity there, you know, the richer the king, the more elaborate the temple. But that tree where the deity stood originally was still maintained as its sthalavriksha. I'll tell you about Chennai, for example. If any of you has seen it, the Kapalishwar temple has the Alexandrian laurel as the sacred tree. Now, the original deity is very tiny and is kept on one side. It's kept, I think, on the southern side today. But originally, it was under the Punnai tree. In the case of this, it was actually under the tree, which is now the Santhom Cathedral. And though the cathedral, the Portuguese broke down the church and sent out the Hindus and the temple was rebuilt in Mylapore, the cathedral has still kept the sacred tree, the sthalavriksha. They didn't cut down the tree. That's very interesting. And in many other places, in Vaidheshwaran Kovil near Kumbakonam, the original tiny linga is still under the neem tree, while the main deity is a huge lingam inside the temple. So sthalavrikshas, as the culture of temples grew, the tree under which the original deity was first kept was replaced by temple, and those trees became the sthalavrikshas. So the sacred tree became secondary and became just a part of the faith. But for a person who knows, they will always go to the sthalavriksha of a temple. when you go to a temple, you always go to the sthala vriksha. And of course, the most sacred plant was rice. Rice is goddess Annapurna herself. This is a pipal tree puja in Uttar Pradesh. Then of course, tulsi and the khejarli. Now the reason I put the khejarli or the shami is that in the Rig Veda, only the pipal and the shami could be used to create agni, the sacrificial fire, the sacred fire. And even today, when you have a havan, homam, you have used the pipal and the shami to produce the fire. Of course, today, priests may be using matchboxes, even putting a little something, camphor or something, but this is what you're supposed to do. Shami is the khejarli, which you see in Rajasthan, which is worshipped by the Bishnois. No, it's not a fragrant tree, but it is very important for the black buck, which is required for the desert ecology of that Jodhpur area. None of them are fragrant. Actually, it's very interesting. No sacred groves have economically useful trees. In fact, even when we restore them, they say, please don't plant mango and coconut and all, because then there will become a fight. Will I get the mangoes? I took 20, you took 30. So they do not want trees which are of any economic value. They only want medicinal plants, yes? Well, every temple offers a variety of herbs. But since you mentioned Meenakshi, I must tell you that they have 300 acres of the temple land, a little beyond the temple. And we started a program over there by which a person donates so much money, and they, I think it's 100 rupees or something, and they say, this is my name and this is my star and so on. And we planted a tree over there, and the money was kept by the temple. And every year on that person's star birthday, supposing it came this month in on this day, they would send the prasad to that person. Could be. I really don't know what they were offering. But all of them offer various types of herbs. In fact, the herbs which are used for the Abhishekam goes into the temple tanks. And I will come to the temple tanks later. That is why the temple tanks are very sacred and very, very medicinal. So, to come back to this, some are associated with the deity. For example, the Bilva is Shiva's tree. The Neem tree is with Devi. Tulsi with Krishna. They were used to shelter an object of worship or the deity. Yes, somebody said something. Some plants are believed to have originated from the bodies of the gods, like Rudraksha is supposed to be the tears of Lord Shiva. And some plants became sacred because of what might have happened beneath them, like the pipal under which Lord Buddha attained enlightenment. And very many plants with important social or economic roles were considered sacred, like the khejarli, which you asked. In fact, Guru Jamboji of the Bishnois, his whole thing was that you shall not cut a khejarli or kill a black buck. I will be reborn as a black buck and I need the khejarli. And the original chipko, the chipko is this thing that happened in Haryana, I think, but the original chipko happened with these Bishnois women, the 363 women who hugged the tree and were still cut down by the woodcutters of the Maharaja of Jodhpur. So that is the original chipko movement. And for example, where I live in Chennai, the tree over here, I think it's mentioned, the economic value of plants was known. The sacred tree was the Alexandrian laurel. And not many people today are aware that the Alexandrian laurel called the Punne was used to build the ships with which the Tamils sailed all the way to Southeast Asia. Rajendra Chola took his entire army, conquered Malaysia, Singapore, and Indonesia. It went as far as Vietnam, China. So that was the wood. So it became the sacred tree. So ancient Indians knew the ecological value of plants, the oxygen production of the people and its effect on the brain, the importance of the banyan as a home for fruit dispersing bats. Around Madurai, there are several banyan tree groves with exclusive banyan trees, and they are all the homes of fruit bats. And not even one leaf can you touch. I've been to these places because they need the fruit bats for seed dispersal. That is how careful they were. So these plants were protected by being deemed sacred. So they protected the forest, the plants, everything by calling them sacred. Now we come to the waters. And I don't have to tell you why water is important. We can't survive without it. But all rivers, lakes, and so on are associated with goddesses generally, except Brahmaputra and the Krishna, who are male deities. And most Indian rivers are believed to be divine manifestations. And polluting water is a great sin. The Rig Veda praises rivers in the Nadi Stuti Sukta. And one thing I'd like to say, which is very interesting, the Rig Veda lists 10 rivers. And interestingly, it starts in the east. Now, if we say this has nothing to do with what I'm talking, but if the Aryans invaded India, they should have started with the western rivers and then gone east. But they don't. They start with the Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Shutudri, Parishni, and so on. And then the next stanza talks about the northwestern rivers, which are in modern Afghanistan and Pakistan. So they are going from east to west, which means that the people, I don't know, that's your subject. They went from east to west, Professor Danino. Maybe that's another subject for another lecture. So I would like to mention that every river was regarded as sacred, and in every puja, they say Gange cha Yamune chaiva Godavari Saraswati Narmada Sindhu Kaveri Jale Asmin Sannidhim Kuru. So, which means, O sacred Ganga, Yamuna, Godavari, Saraswati, Narmada, Sindhu, Kaveri, please be present in this water beside me and make it sacred. It may just be a small panchapatra of water, but that is the prayer that is still said. So, the waters are this foundation. And when we say pilgrimage sites were always found along river banks. And the word Tirtha actually was a ford of two rivers. But then the word Tirtha became sacred because that is where Tirthasthan. So, people who went on pilgrimage, and in a language like Tamil, for example, many languages, the word Tirtha has become water itself. You know, please get me a glass of water. Please bring me some Tirtha. So on. So then apart from that, we also have the concept of sacred lakes. You have natural lakes like Mansarovar. And I mentioned Mansarovar versus Rakshasthal because Mansarovar is fresh water. Rakshasthal, which is just a couple of kilometers away, is salt water. And also, although there is a channel connecting the two, it's the salt water never goes to Mansarovar. It's only fresh water which may go to Rakshasthal. It's quite amazing. And I saw it and it's horrible. Rakshasthal looks as if that is where Ravana was supposed to have bathed before he tried to lift Kailasa. Of course, Shiva pressed it down, but it looks like a place where a Ravana would have stayed. I went there and it was such a gloomy, deserted, horrible place. Even Mansarovar is deserted. But there's so much happiness over there. At night, you see the stars shining in the Mansarovar Lake, which you don't see in Rakshasthal, and so on. Now, desilting a lake is a dharma. Yesterday, I discussed dharma, you know, which is the law of righteousness which we should carry out. One of the dharmas are the desilting, and the entire village, if you go into regional literature, you will find that the entire village participated in the desilting. The silt, what did they do with the silt? Now, our Ganesh Chaturthi, Durga Puja were all celebrated with the silt. For example, Ganesh Chaturthi, in summer, you had the desilting. They would make the Ganesh figures out of this wet clay, worship it for generally 3 days. Now it's gone to 11 days. They never painted it. You know, they never baked it, painted it, because at the end of the puja, you put it back in the water. So, you know, you come out of water and you go back into water. Now, of course, we bake it, we paint it, we use plaster of Paris. It's most ecologically unsustainable. But the original origins of Ganesh Chaturthi and Durga Puja, even Durga Puja has become totally unsustainable. But it was so beautifully done. It was using this desilted clay, which was at the bottom of the lake. Now I come to the last kind of sacred water, which is the only thing that is used. That is the temple tank. The temple tank is actually a rainwater harvesting structure which maintains the groundwater table. And people are not allowed to use it except during a time of drought. The water is very medicinal, what you asked me, because all the Abhisheka Jalam goes into the tank. So it is extremely medicinal water. And in fact, when people are very sick, they bring their children or somebody who's ill is brought to the local temple tank to drink the water. It supports a variety of temple of life forms and is maintained by the temples. And here, Professor Danino, who is the expert on the Indus Valley civilization, I would like to say that the great, so-called great bath of the Indus Saraswati was a temple tank, because Indians never had swimming pools in the past. This common bath is totally alien to us. It's a very modern concept, and it could only have been a temple tank. Pushkar Lake, which is, do you know, this is an artificial lake, and it's got, of course, a myth behind it. So is the Rani Ki Vav step well. And this is the sacred, this is what I said about on this side is Rakshasthal and this side is Mansarovar. I come to the next, which is the sacred animals. One more aspect of our environment, which is very important for us, the animals. India's greatest contribution to world thought is, as I said yesterday, ahimsa. No other culture, no other people, nowhere else has the concept of ahimsa at all. And the Yajurveda says, no person should kill animals who are helpful to all. By serving them, one should obtain heaven. And this term is an important spiritual doctrine shared by Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism. It has been described as a multidimensional concept inspired by the belief that the Supreme Being lives in all living beings. And yesterday I discussed karma, rebirth, because this is part of the entire concept of looking forward to looking after animals. Now, it's very interesting that the concept of veganism, which is coming up for the first time, I mean, even I had not heard of vegans earlier, but in the Rig Veda, it says the Yatudhana, that is the person who fills himself with the flesh of man, he who fills himself with the flesh of horses or other animals, and he who steals the milk of the cow, Lord, cut off their heads with your flame. So it's very interesting that the concept of non-drinking milk is equivalent to cannibalism and the eating of horses, because as you know, the horses were very sacred, important for them. The earth was created for the enjoyment of bipeds and quadrupeds, birds, animals, and other creatures, not humans alone. Yesterday we discussed this, the Kapistala Katha, Samhita of the Yajurveda, which refers to the idea of non-violence to animals, the Chandogya Upanishad, which bars violence against all creatures, and names Ahimsa as one of the five essential virtues. Ahimsa as a concept was first mentioned in the Rig Veda. It develops later on, and it was taken to great heights by the Buddha and especially Mahavira. And I think that later on, even at the time of Buddha and Mahavira, vegetarianism was not so important. I think that came with Adi Shankara, the 7th, 8th century, who really went around the country and stopped animal sacrifice in many temples. So these are people who have contributed to the protection of animals. I've just quoted a lot of different sources saying that you must be he who injures innocent beings with a desire to give himself pleasure, never finds happiness. You know who is the first animal welfare activist in our this thing? Thirukkural was there, Thiruvalluvar, but even before him. Can anyone guess? No? Sita. If you read the Ramayana, Sita tells Rama, you can kill a stag if you're hungry. You can cook it and eat it if you are hungry and there's no other food. But you must not hunt for pleasure. I mean, anti-hunting, she was the first to talk about it. Amazing. And nobody talks about that. So how were animals given sanctity? Some became gods themselves, like Ganesha or Vagdeva. Vagdeva was the tiger god of central India. The elephant is a keystone species. And why is he Vighneshwara, remover of obstacles? Because the elephant is the person who makes pathways in the forest for people, for other animals. And they dig and make the, if there are any zoologists here, you'll know, they dig and they make the ponds which harvest rainwater. So the attributes of the elephant were given to Ganesha. Many, of course, were divine vehicles of the gods. Garuda for Vishnu, Nandi for Shiva, goes on. Some like Hanuman and dog were man's friends. And here I would say, although Rama is not an animal activist unlike Sita, he made a lot of animals sacred, like Hanuman was his friend, because of which every temple in India has lots of monkeys and looks after them. And I would say Jambavan the bear, they've even created a Jambavan bear sanctuary in Kishkinda. The other animal is, of course, Jatayu, the vulture, was made again sacred by Rama. And the fourth animal is the squirrel, who helped Rama, the monkeys, build a setu to Lanka. Similarly, the cow, the sanctity of the cow really developed with Krishna, who, of course, as you know, was the great cowherd. Some were deemed sacred because of their economic value. The cow was essential for milk, and not just for milk. The cow was worshipped as a mother. You know, people did not drink that much milk. Her motherhood came because she was the mother of the bull. And the bullock was essential because it was able to pull the cart. It was used for plowing, agriculture. It's only now that you have cars and tractors. The bullock was the draft animal. So the cow as the mother was the mother of the bull. So that was one of the main reasons. She also gave milk, which every child drank. But if you see scriptures, they talk about how she gives birth to the bulls. And all through, the gods are called, Indra is called a bull. Everybody in the Veda is a bull. And of course, the black buck, which was essential for the survival of the big kejri plant. It nibbles on the kejri plant and helps it to grow. And this is the mainstay of the desert. Some animals were part of social history. Mahisha, the buffalo. Now, this is a very sociological phenomenon. Why did Mahisha become a villain? And that is because when the agriculturists, when people became food producers, they pushed the tribes of India into the forest. So the Gonds and Maria Gonds, who are the tribes of central India, they are buffalo worshippers. In the south, the Todas, who are buffalo worshippers, were pushed again by the agriculturists away into the Nilgiri hills. So you will find that it is the tribes of India who worship the buffaloes. And I believe that long before we had agriculture in India, people were pastoral, and the buffalo was the animal, because it gave milk, it gave meat, it gave everything. And that was the animal that was herded by people. It was worshipped by the indigenous pastoral tribes of India. And the war between Mahisha and Durga replicates the conflict between the buffalo-worshipping pastoral tribes and the agriculturists who worship the Matva goddess. But Mahisha still lives on as the god of the Todas, the Gonds, and so on. You have the deity Mahasobha in Maharashtra, Mahisasur in Madhya Pradesh, and so on. Many families have a totemic tradition. Those who know about know their Gotra names. Bharadwaja, do you know it means owl? Garga comes from the word crocodile. Rishyashringa, born of a doe. Jambuka, jackal. Gautama, rabbit. There are also Gotra names from plants, Kaushika. And many clan names have animal origins. Maurya comes from the word Mor, Maurya, More. And Ghorpade comes from the monitor lizard. These Ghorpades could throw the lizards up in the Maratha army, cling on, and from the the animal, they'd have it was a monitor lizard, they'd have a rope and they could climb up. So animals in Indian tradition are recognized as having feelings, passions, as human beings, and they do. I have seen cows, bulls, buffaloes cry as they're taken to slaughter, cry before they go to slaughter. These Jallikattu bulls cry. If you look at the TV, you find that they're crying all the time. I've seen elephants cry. It's horrible. You go to Rajasthan, Amber, you'll see the elephants cry. By recognizing the divinity in animals, they had a unique position which helped protect many species. The deification of several animals led to their protection, a safeguard that was lost in the medieval, colonial, and post-colonial periods, when many animals were described as vermin and hunted to death. The British gave 25 rupees for every head of leopard and tiger and lion that was killed. They were all vermin. So there are three paths to marga: jnana, bhakti, karma. And a human being can consciously choose his path, so can animals. What is interesting is that every medieval saint preached kindness to animals. Even Guru Nanak preached kindness to animals and vegetarianism. And of course, Guru Jamboji of the Bishnois died leaving behind guiding principles for his community. Finally, we come to the sacred mountains. And here I'd like to quote something from Kalidasa: Astyuttarasyam Vishideva Dhatma Himalayona Manakadi Raja. Revered by all stands the massive mountain, the divine Himalayas, in the north of India, running its course from the eastern seas to the western ocean. It provides a measure for the earth's dimensions. So that is how they revere. I mean, those of you who have been to the Himalayas know that it is the most imposing site in the world. It is the source of water, fertility, and healing. They play a vital role in the conservation of local ecology. So the mountain itself was regarded as sacred, not just, you know, building a temple on the mountain. For example, Thiruvannamalai near Chennai, the mountain is the Shivalinga itself. And why? Because they were totally comprehensive ecosystems. Due to their topographic location and biocultural richness, they provided opportunities for climate change adaptation and act as a refuge for plants and animals during environmental change and from competing species. The snow leopard has survived because it is locked in the remote Himalayas. Sacred mountains and sacred sites within mountains have resulted in communities maintaining and preserving their natural resources in pristine conditions. I mean, look at Ladakh. Each mountain is a different color, pink, blue, purple. It's amazing. And that is because they're full of minerals. I'm going to rush through. Some are designated as sacred because of tradition, like Mount Kailasa, which is believed to be the axis bundi of the world. Was it the mythical Mount Meru? And what is interesting is that it remains unclimbed. Europeans have tried to climb it. Chinese have tried to climb it, and nobody has come back alive. Now the Chinese have banned even attempts at climbing it. But what is important is that the mountains were the inspiration for our temples. And most temples are designed as symbols of Mount Meru, and which is a part of the cosmic ocean. The sun, planets, and stars are believed to circle the mountain as a single unit. And the best recreation of this is the Hindu temple of Angkor Wat in Cambodia, with its central Meru, five spires representing the five peaks, the seven walls. Now there aren't seven left anymore, but they are symbolic of the seven continents, and they are interspersed with motes that represented the oceans. Meru sits on Jambudvipa, which is the earth's landmass, and to the south of Jambudvipa is Bharatavarsha. Now, when I say this, you'll think that I'm talking about India, but this is what they will tell you when you go to Cambodia. Very interestingly, the Om Parvat, this is how mystical mountains are, have the Om in the snow. So some are associated with individual gods and saints, like Govardhana is associated with Krishna, who lifted the mountain. Some are places of spiritual attainment. But in order to be sustainable over the long term, environmental policies have to take in values and ideals. Otherwise, they will fail to enlist local and popular support. Final thing is, of course, the sacred seeds, which are closely connected with culture. And traditional agriculture in India, it's very important because we are losing our traditional seeds to Monsanto. Women play a major role in seed conservation. They decide on the seeds to be preserved, preservation methods, conservation and propagation. On the day of sowing, they keep it before the puja and they worship the seeds, worship the draft animals, the plow, and then they go ahead and start the plantation. Seeds are symbolic of fertility, eternity, and sustenance. Very interestingly, all the modern hybrid seeds are never worshipped. All the Monsanto seeds are never worshipped. Because I also am a farmer, and I have seen in our village, nobody worships those seeds. Of course, the most important are the Navadhanya. And I'm not going to read out which are the Navadhanya because, interestingly, they change from place to place. So whatever is important in a certain geographic area becomes part of the Navadhanya. So, my friends, sacred ecology is uniquely Indian. The ecological traditions are pan-Indian, celebrated all over India. So did the British really create India? I think the commonality of our sacred ecology suggests otherwise. We celebrate festivals, which are again a celebration of the ecology and which are common throughout India, like take harvest, Bhogi, Pongal, we have Lohri in Tamil Nadu, Lohri in Punjab, Bihu in Assam, Sankranti in Gujarat. I can just go on. Then we celebrate Agni through Deepavali, Kartikeya Deepam, flowers, Onam in Kerala, Batukamma in Telangana. So I end by saying that the Atharva Veda says it is up to us, the children of Mother Earth, to live in peace and harmony with all others. O Mother Earth, you are the world for us and we are your children. Let us speak in one accord, let us come together so that we live in peace and harmony and be cordial and gracious in our relationship with other beings. The divine is all and all life is to be treated with reverence and respect. The family of Mother Earth, Vasudeva Kutumbakam, must promote Sarva Bhuta Hita, And as I said yesterday, because I see some new faces today, our politicians keep saying Vasudeva Kutumbakam. But the Vasudeva Kutumbakam should be promoting Sarva Bhuta Hita, that is, the welfare of all beings, people, animals, and trees. If forests and trees, fresh water, and clean air disappear, so will all life on earth. Thank you very much.